Well, good afternoon. Phil, welcome to the Next Generation Train Control Conference being held in Philadelphia this month. You can't be there, I can't be there, and we wanted to hear about your project, and so we thought doing an armchair discussion would be a really good way of you being able to still reach the delegates at the conference. So we're going to talk about the On-Corridor project, which Metrolinx are promoting. I think it's the largest and most extensive rail infrastructure project in Canada's history. Can you give us a brief outline of the project scope and the timings and the cost as you know it?
Absolutely. So thank you very much for this conversation. So what's really exciting about our On-Corridor project is we're increasing our capacity of our regional rail services by a factor of three. 300% relative to what we do today. That brings a huge amount of issues with it. So first of all, huge civil infrastructure, rail-to-rail grade separations, rail-to-road grade separations, more track, 200 kilometers more track. But as you know, Mike, when you increase capacity, it's all about the signaling system. And this is why what choice of signaling system we exercise is really crucial. There's a lot about this contract that makes it commercially novel as well. And so to help with this, how the audience understand the choice of signaling system, we have what's called a prime bonus. That's a substantial value that we will pay to the successful contractor if the economic benefits of the solution that's being designed achieves what they say it achieves. So don't just sell us a signaling system. We're going to measure whether we achieve the journey time savings and the capacity improvements that that system must give us, and you will earn your bonus against those. On top of that, you have to convince us that we're going to get the capacity and the journey time benefits from the whole project.
So you've got new trains, electrification, more platforms, more tracks, more civil works. Your trains are going to work harder because they'll be going faster, shorter journey times. The striking thing about this model is this two-year period at the beginning where you and the P3, the contractors, work together collaboratively to work through their initial bid and almost workshop a solution that everyone buys into. Yeah. Can you talk to me about that? How that came about?
A super question, because it links to the way the benefits work. So you call it the P3, and let's immediately just clarify what P3 means. P3 can mean different things to different people. What is our contract and what is it not? P3s for me means a collaborative contract with the private sector. P3s to some other people mean a fixed price lump sum contract with financing attached to ensure performance against the contract. Our contract for On-Corridor is probably going to be more than $10 billion.
Wow.
And it's not tied to project financing or to financing. It's a collaborative contract whereby we, so sort of called progressive design build type contract, whereby there's a development phase during which the parties agree on the risk transfer that is inherent in the scope that's being delivered. We agree on the costs, and then we agree on a target price. And the target price has a pain gain share mechanism with it. So we agree what risk contingencies are within the basic cost. We agree what the final outcome price is. We agree all of that against the scope. We agree who's doing what to mitigate the risk. And then from that point onwards, if there's an underperformance of that target price, there's gains to be shared between us and the contracting party. And then if there's overshoot, there's pain to be shared by ratios. And so that's a progressive delivery model where instead of transferring all of the risk and then get a fixed price, which is then claimed and contested and claim lists of claims against it afterwards, this is collaborative.
So that's really interesting. So it's a kind of a design build, but progressive. The funding is slightly different. And operations and maintenance?
Not funding. Funding is the same. Sort of, it's just how we agree on the commercial terms.
And operations and maintenance?
So operations and maintenance is included in the scope. But we have the options. If we can't agree on this, on the operation maintenance, we can adjust what is in the contract or not in the contract.
So you have a winning team now, and they won on some sort of scope. You now enter 2 years of workshop and collaborative behavior. It's very different to the P3 model so far in Canada. I've seen it in the UK, but it sounds like this, the pain, gain, share, and collaborative is setting up for success from the beginning rather than this culture claims environment.
Absolutely, Mike, you've got it in one. You've got the main principle exactly right. What struck me about this contract, and I can tell you honestly, we started out thinking that this could be a finance-based lump sum contract, and very quickly changed that view and made it this collaborative model because of the number of trade-offs and choices and complexity you have in deciding what the design looks like. And what's really positive about this is in a normal P3, we would do a reference concept design and say, come on, Mike, this is what you have to achieve and this is what you have to bid to. This project, because there are so many, because it's a brownfield site, so many trade-offs between choices of service pattern, infrastructure to be built against it, technology you can use to get more capacity rather than more hard investment to get more capacity. Because there are so many trade-offs, we actually turned to the bidders and said, we're not going to tell you what to build. We're going to show you there's a way you can achieve this, but you have all of the flexibility. If you have a better signaling system, if you have a better loco, electric loco, if you've got a better proposal to run the service, better ways to operate, and all of that can achieve the economic benefits, we're going to measure you not against a price or a scope that you've pinned it to. We're going to finalize that in the development phase, but we're going to measure you against the outcomes that this achieves. It's philosophically hugely different to the typical way of going to the market and say, I want a P3 partnership, but I'm going to tell you what to do in any case.
So it's very different to the other P3 models in Canada.
It's very different.
They're not tied to an output spec where you have no say.
It's tied to an outcome, which is an economic outcome, but it's not a fixed price, which is a big difference with other P3s.
That's amazing. And you talked about cost. You said up to 6 billion, 10 billion?
No. We envisage it to be higher than 10 billion. But the reason I don't want to pin it to an exact amount is the final approval by our government is still to follow.
So it's either side of 10 billion.
No, not either side. It's probably more than 10.
Okay, plus 10. How about the timescale? What's the timescale for the whole project?
So because whenever you do big projects like this, which is not limited to just like a point A to point B LRT or a subway or the like, because it's a brownfield running railway with stuff that gets added that then enables different train service plans, we've got a concept that is used in other jurisdictions of configuration states. The timeline would be over 7.5 to 10 years, what configuration states are achieved. The configuration state is a combination of infrastructure built, systems built, trains delivered. Doesn't have to be all of the trains delivered. How many trains delivered? Doesn't have to be have all of electrification done, but which electrification is done? People trained, etc. Maintenance facilities ready. So different configuration states would enable different train service plans that will gradually become more intense as train service plans. And during that ensures that during the build cycle of 7.5 to 10 years, you can gradually and continuously increase your number of train services you run and the benefit you give to your customers.
So it's great to see it as a joined up program, and as things shift, everything shifts together rather than it being disjointed. Throughout the 2-year design and construction phase, working collaboratively, What do you think the key risks or challenges to the program are? And any thoughts about other than the negotiation and consultation?
So think about it this way. In the development phase, the key words that sort of describe what the development phase is about is the development phase is where the risk transfer between the parties are defined. So the way you phrase the question, let me respond to that. What key risks do I see? All of the risks must be flighted in the development phase. Now, for sure, there are some risks you as a contractor can take on. Please take that on and manage that. Which are the risks I can help you with? And we thrash that out and figure that out during the development phase. So typical issues around design risk, construction risk, fleet delivery risk, to name the big ones. Signaling system risk, to name the big ones, are what's really important. And perhaps for your audience then, if I can talk about signaling risks. Signaling systems are phenomenally important to anything you do in the railway, because it just gives you those two really key things you need from a railway, and that's capacity and safety. And so I am sort of one of those people that are definitely not a signaling expert, but I know enough about signaling just for me to be dangerous when I talk about signaling. But signaling for me is fabulously important, and I'm concerned that some of the sort of reliability of projecting the time to implement complex communication-based signaling solutions is so grey. It's so unspecific.
Yeah, I get that. On the Jubilee Line extension in London in the 90s, the signaling was almost thought as an add-on, and the control centre, so the shiny new stations, the shiny new trains, really took the hype, you know, front stage. And then people think, oh yeah, no, the signaling, because without it, nothing else works, yeah. I think. I've done three brownfield CBTC signaling projects now, and greenfield is easier because you get so much more access and you're not running the service. But brownfield for you, you're going to have to keep running every day do this on stop.
So one of the things your audience will be interested in, and I know from your my conversations before started, is sort of thinking about what are we thinking. What are we considering when we think about the signaling risks and signaling outcomes, and what do we want when we think about signaling on this project? And in my own mind, I see sort of three levels of stuff. Look, I want outcomes. I definitely need certainty on the capacity I'm going to get. I definitely need the safety features, sort of red light or red aspect, red aspect adherence, safety, and not to violate red aspects. I need to have an understanding of switch positions. So what is the railway in front of the train safe? I need overspeed control. I need that because we've seen how many trains derail because there's no overspeed control. And the fourth one is really important, which we will be figuring out how we get that, is work block safety. So if there are work blocks that the train knows and the crew knows there's a work block coming up, and all of this point-to-point radio approvals and safety management can be replaced by something that's more robust. So safety we want, capacity we want, that becomes level one. The level two of what we are thinking that's really important are things like let's call it the constructability for me. So it's outcomes is level one, constructability of a brownfield site, getting something implemented within a decent timeline. And this is where I'm worried about, you know, ETCS level two and all of these things about, you know, give me a firm timeline so I know it's going to be implemented, and that's not dependent on convoluted configuration management or software or stuff like that. I want to be certain that it can be implemented. And then at level three, what we're thinking about signaling is really important, are all of the user requirements. Remote condition monitoring? Is it modular enough? Does it allow for quick transfer, quick recovery of the system? If module A is broken, you can replace module A briskly and simply without too much resetting. Inherent reliability of the system. These are the things that are really important for me. And that's how we think about it. And that's what we'll be asking for.
Of course, journey time, because you want a faster journey time, I guess, as well. And the signal.
Okay, journey time, that's built into the outcomes, obviously, into the capacity. When I talk about capacity, for me, is the size of the pipe and how fast things move through the pipe.
So just picking up, you operate some lines yourself, and you're guests of host railways for CN and CP. How are you going to operate with those two very different sets of companies over shared track?
You're right. That is a question, but we call it, and it's commonly called, when you start to get into these modern signaling systems, commonly called sort of overlays. And we can see, obviously, we've got two different worlds that we'll be trying to get to collaborate. It'll be a fixed block world and a moving block world that we'll be in effect try to bring together, and this has been done where you can have your, we don't see that we take the lights at the end of a stick away from the existing railway. We'll still have the existing gantries and signals. It may be that if we change the sizes of the blocks that you are in, that we actually have changes in the configuration of the lights on the gantry itself to get you to have smaller blocks, because passenger services need smaller blocks. So you can say the train is not in section and you don't have to wait till it's out of the full big block till the next train can come in. So if you want more capacity, you need to move to smaller blocks. But obviously, if we do that with a modern signaling system and with in-cab signaling, what's left outside of the cab in the overlay for freight needs to be able to work with this. We think this is fixable. This is part of what needs to be done in the development phase.
Particularly for the engineers on the trains.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. That it's easy to drive.
Absolutely. But we know this has been done in the States in places where the freight operators still have their signaling and identified what their blocks are that they operate in, and the passenger services operate in a smaller block and therefore
for
higher
sure.
capacity.
I see in the Northeast Corridor, particularly the collaboration between transit agencies, Amtrak, New Jersey Transit and so on, Long Island Railroad, and freight companies, and how they manage PTC, positive train control, between the two of them. And so positive train control or ETCS level 1 and 2 are going to be new to Canada. And it would be interesting to see the journey you have with the regulators as well, because it's going to be so new.
I'm very open with our colleagues and our supply chain. Obviously we're all aware of what ETCS level 1, level 2 can give and how it fits. But you know, I got to have certainty on schedule, and I know some of the ETCS level 2 implementations have been challenging. And I can't expose our ridership, our market, our capacity requirements. We're going to grow from around 9 billion people in the GTHA area now to 20 years from now, we're going to have about 50% more, 15 million people. And 15 million people, I mean, this is a massive market. I got to get this capacity in. I got to get this built. You know, I've made my position clear. If the only answer left to give us certainty on implementation is a conventional signaling solution, we'll do conventional.
Okay, so, excuse me, I think the good news is you'll get everything you want. And I think the signaling companies have a lot of automation, autonomy, AI stuff, which will help the driver and will add value in terms of the bells and whistles to the system. You said 20 years. Kind of the final question really is, fast forward 20 years, What does GO Transit and Metrolinx look like, do you think? What's your vision for 20 years' time?
Well, I see a regional rail service, which is what we are, that has a subway frequency feel to it, sort of train every 5 to 10 minutes arriving. You don't have to check your timetable, you just
turn up and go.
Very excited about that. I see shorter trains because I see journey patterns and journey choices and journey planning by customers to be less about a morning commute and an evening commute and more about I'm traveling across different parts of, I'm working in different parts of the GTHA, the Greater Toronto Hamilton area, and I'm moving around easily using public transit. I also see huge customer satisfaction. We've got a philosophy here of customer satisfaction being crucial, and I'm targeting, and then we measure ourselves very critically on customer satisfaction. So I see huge, our customer satisfaction scores to be in the mid 80s and higher is where it is today.
So faster, more frequent, a more pleasant journey, a more reliable journey.
More reliable journey, punctual, all of those performance characteristics and obviously table stakes, absolute safety, not only for people on our railway, but also for the public in great level crossings, replaced with grade separations where appropriate to keep road traffic and people traffic away from the railway fully fenced in. Really a responsible community place for us to be.
Well, I'm very excited about the project. As a citizen of Ontario and Toronto, I have a vested interest. We're out of time, so thanks very much for your time. If you want to know more about the On Corridor project, the address is coming up on the screen and you can go and have a look at it yourself. Phil, thanks very much. I'm gonna hand back to the conference and Bill. Bill? Yeah, I didn't make a joke about you having a nap, and Phil is a friend of Axel Counters. So Daryl, if you're there, Axel Counters is good.